Right. Welcome, everyone. Welcome to AGL Live. It's great to have everyone here today. I'm Melinda Burgess, and I'll start off by telling you a little more about our organization. AGL is a nonprofit association working to help government modernize through shared knowledge and community. You can visit our website at agilegovleaders.org to learn more about our work and the ways you can get involved. Today, we're here to discuss bridging silos for better government, and we have a fantastic panel of folks here today, and we'll let them introduce themselves in just a moment. And at the end of the discussion, we do have a book giveaway, so stick around for that to find out if you've won a free copy of Jim Benson's book, Personal Kanban. A personal favorite of mine. And meanwhile, as the discussion is going on, we are welcoming audience questions via the chat. You can use the chat icon at the bottom of your screen to add any questions that you would like to hear from the panelists on, and we'll do our best to answer them. And because we have a small intimate group today, we're breaking a little from our usual format, and we invite you to put your video on if you wish, because later we'll be inviting conversation and sharing from the audience. So leave your mic on mute, but feel free to use video. And with that, I will hand it over to our moderator, Alexa Choi, to introduce herself and get things started. Hi, Alexa.
Hi, Melinda. Hello, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us this afternoon or early afternoon, depending on where you are, or evening, as Alex is calling in from Switzerland. Today, we're going to be talking about bridging silos for better government. It's a topic that I think we kind of encounter every single day. We're really excited. And as Melinda had mentioned, after about 10 till, we're going to be opening it up for people to share the, you know, share your stories. So please feel free to share your video if you like, and then we will share stories towards the end. But with that, we're going to go ahead and get started. I'm Alexa Choi, your moderator. We're going to go ahead and go around and introduce our panelists because it's a very tremendous panel. So we'll start. Go ahead and start with Alex.
Yeah. So good evening or good morning. I don't know what's her. It's better for you. So my name is Alex and Cuva. I'm an Agile coach in Switzerland and some other countries, mostly in Asia. I'm mostly coaching insurance and financial companies, but also government currently. I'm coaching the Swiss Confederation. So it's like the federal government in Switzerland. We have a transformation of one of the offices in Geneva.
Perfect. Thank you so much, Alex. I really appreciate it. We're going to move on to Kitty.
Hi, everybody. I'm Kitty Wooley, and I probably won't run down my LinkedIn profile, but the gist of my career has been that I was a college financial aid director. And then I moved over to government and reviewed financial aid operations at universities and colleges. And then I came to DC and started working with on a system, a risk management system build. And then I wound up doing communications and outreach for a great big waterfall project, which combined Pell Grant and student loan processing. So basically what I've done is approach the same task from multiple perspectives. And what that ended up doing was pulling me into a bunch of conversations where I was actually introducing groups to each other who I thought surely already knew each other and were working together, but who were not. And in order to get the projects done, they had to be talking to each other. And so I basically ended up doing that in four different components of the Department of Education for 19 years.
Wow, perfect. Thank you so much, Kitty. Appreciate it. We're going to come over to Michael.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for having me here. It's a pleasure. I do culture and leadership training worldwide, both publicly and privately. The organization I created is really to help organizations approach agile transformation in a very different way, redefined, like a fundamental rethink in a way that engages managers, executives in an integrated way with what's happening usually when agile's thought of as this team. And it really just brings this perspective of wave two of agile, this broader perspective or deeper understanding of agile. that it's really about culture. It's really about leadership. And we need to understand all of these things and actually to have any chance with our change programs and any chance in breaking down the silos, whether in government or private sector. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. Appreciate it. And we're going to come around to Linda.
Linda Cureton. I'm the CEO of Muse Technologies. I started Muse in 2013, 10 minutes after I retired from government as the NASA CIO of NASA. I was at NASA for 9 years. I retired from the government with 34 years of executive service. I was at agencies like Department of Justice, Treasury, Department of Energy. And my background is technical, but my expertise has been in organizational change. So when I started Muse in 2014, I started a company that I wish I had as a CIO, which is support organizational change. And that looks like things like culture, process, psychological change, you know, even that. So we do business process reengineering, agile coaching, leadership development, soft skills training, project and program management. We're a woman-owned small business and an 8A. We're headquartered in Atlanta, Maryland.
Perfect. Thank you so much, Linda. And I'm also going to kick off the panel discussion with the first question geared to you. So first question is, what are the right ways and wrong ways to introduce a new policy method or other change in the context of government modernization? And how does bridging silos factor into this?
So I think that one of the wrong ways, I'll start with that, which is probably the common way, is to shove it down somebody's throat. You know, to say, you have to do it. Top down is a way that works. So in the government space, a lot of change comes in through political leadership. And that political leadership looks at the career workforce and say, hey, you know, you have to change or else, you know, get on the program or get out. Well, that causes a temporary change for maybe 5 minutes. And then as soon as you turn your back, it's over. It's reverted. The organization has reverted back to the way that it used to be. And so this shoving down the throat, I think it accomplishes temporary change, but lasting change is done in a different kind of way, which means incentives for people to learn, to grow, and to want to do things. I think that organizations behave a lot like human bodies in a way, and they build up antibodies to change. And so the change leader will have to do things like inoculate against those antibodies in order to make sure that the health of the patient, which is the change that you want to accomplish, actually happens.
That's a fascinating analogy. Mm-hmm. I like that. Very interesting. Thank you so much, Linda. Alex, Michael, or Kitty, anybody else want to take on that question?
Yeah, so this is Michael. I'll tag on. So I totally agree with what Linda just shared here. And I'll go further, and maybe, if I may. And so we all know transformation programs where people aren't consulted in what happens. The business usual, you know, people hold onto their rock and wait for the wave to pass. And usually it takes 18 months or 3 years till it passes. And then there's, you know, and they bring up their head for air and then there's a new wave, right? You know, we've trained people to do that, to ignore what's happening and not involving them. So we actually need a shift in consciousness or mindset of how we're approaching change itself. This is what Linda was speaking to. And when I say that, we can no longer, if we keep on doing business as usual, we keep on getting business as usual. The purpose of any of these changes, process, policy changes, et cetera, are to improve how things are functioning. That's the intention. So if we go back to the intention of how do we actually move a system towards a better way of operating, higher levels of performance, more engaged workers, and so on. And when we look at it from the core of what the intention of the change is about, we look at, well, what does it really take to create higher levels of results, of more success? And when we take a step back to look at that, we're going like, oh my goodness, What it depends on is who produces results is people. That unless we have people at the center of what we're undertaking and involving them what's happening, it's not going to work, right? So there's a fundamental rethink about how we approach organizational change that's required to create any success. And if you think about it, we're talking about an agile approach to change. If you think about the core of the agile, it's about people over process. Process is important, but people are the most valuable part. And when we recenter our approach to focus on people, what happens is it requires a reset and a rethink and a throwing away of business as usual for organizational change. And that's really what's required. So just doing agile in your usual business as usual rollout approach and rollout plan is doomed. It has a 100% failure rate. So a fundamental reset of how the change itself is approached is required to actually achieve lasting results and not just be this, you know, thing you see for 5 minutes and then you turn your back and it's gone.
So Michael, are you talking about maybe firing people or like changing the top level management, or are you just basically saying stepping back and looking at exactly what you're trying to accomplish and starting with that first?
So look, so we know from the research that people's brains, when they don't have psychological safety, will shut off, right? So in order to create a successful change program, we need people's brains operating, right? Just basic facts here. Let's go through basic facts of how human beings operate. If they're in fear, the blood flow of the frontal cortex shuts off and people no longer can think. They become relatively unintelligent, right? If you're in fear, you're not going to be very smart. So we want people to be in a high level of psychological safety. That's what high performance comes from. When people are feeling safe and they can express themselves and they can make decisions together, that's where the high performance is going to come from. The results are going to come from that. So talking to people about, or even planning, or even in the background, hiding, headcount reduction, firing executives, firing managers, it's not going to work.
Yeah.
What we want to do is we want to engage with people where they are and invite them to make changes that are comfortable for their, for themselves. It turns out everybody wants to be successful. Every manager wants to be successful. Every worker wants to be successful. So what I'm advocating is fundamentally listening to what's going on with people and helping understand what it is they want and helping them from where they are, right? Some people may want to be moving very quick and some people may want to move slower, and that's okay. When we try to force people to move faster, we just create resistance, we create conflict, we trigger the organizational antibodies Linda was talking about, and it just doesn't work.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for that, Michael. I appreciate it. All right, Kitty.
Well, I had, there's just something, and I don't disagree with anything that's been said so far. There is an interesting bit of research from David Rock and the Neuro Leadership Institute. They've been doing a lot of good work on brain function as it relates to leadership. And one of the things that caught my eye is this sentence: professionals in different functions, finance, operations, legal, marketing, and so forth, literally think with different neurological connections. And the reason I bring that up here is I sort of always thought it was a matter of like getting people on each page, listening to them, and sort of trying to neutralize the toxic resistors and whatnot. But it seems that part of the issue is if you've been doing the same kind of work technically for a long time, you actually have different connections up here. So it's going to require more translation, more talking. The silo thing is real. It's not just organizational. And I hadn't really understood that until I read this. It's pretty well sourced. And that's one of the resources, by the way. I've got three written down, and then I've got this one sitting here, which I'll give you at the end.
Absolutely. Yeah, we're going to get into the resources part, Kitty, so I really appreciate that. It's a good reminder to me to put a star next to my question for that so I don't forget. Yeah, thank you, Kitty. Appreciate that. And Alex, I wanted you to chime in on this one as well.
Yeah. So I completely agree with Michael and anyone else. If I look on what's happening in the government in Switzerland for the different customers I had, one thing we did when we started the project currently is that we ask the managers and all the employees, what is your Agile? What is currently your how you living? Is there any problem? Is fun or you have problem? So I conduct workshop for everyone without the managers and another one with managers. So that people were able to say everything, how they feel at the day, what they see in Agile, what did we bring to them, and so on and so on. It makes me smile that the question was to say that, okay, we fire people. Swiss government, you can fire people. The only reason someone has been fired is because he didn't complete his timesheet. So you don't do your job, yeah. You're not fired.
The government here too, same.
Yeah, so it's not an option there.
Yeah. Okay, perfect. Alex, thank you so much for that. I'm going to go to a question that was actually previously submitted. I think it was submitted when this person registered. Very, very good question. Suggestions specifically on reorganizing government structure to improve agility and collaboration. This is a really good one, and it kind of is a very encompassing question, so I'm going to throw it out there to the panel, and whoever would like to jump on it first, go ahead.
I'll jump on certain aspects of it. So so when I advise executives who want to do organizational change, one of the first things I say, which to an extent falls on deaf ears, is that don't let the first thing you do be a reorganization. They want to come in and they want to reorganize. And the problem with that is that it causes all this organizational turmoil. Everybody's worried about it. You've moved their cheese, all the little cliches that they have. And so they start worrying about, I think Michael had said about their safety. You know, they're in some danger. And so they're not really willing to take any risk to do the things that are being asked of them because they feel a large amount of fear in order to do it. So having said that, if you insist on reorganizing, then I think that one common mistake that I've seen is to not tend to the gaps. So we've created a silo for this, a silo for that. Everybody's in nice little neat little buckets. But where's the horizontal integration? You know, there's more thought about the vertical silos and less about horizontal integration between the new cylinders of excellence that have been created. So my first reaction is don't do it, but then if you must, just tend to those gaps in a very intentional way. And don't believe that you're going to come up with this perfect organization where everything's right. That's like cybersecurity fixed. It's a fallacy. So just get it good enough and then tend to your gaps in things like communication and things like that.
And you know, it's interesting. There's a lot of that's been done, and Project Management Institute is a good source for it on managing in matrixed organizations, because a lot of big projects are matrixed and they pull people from different organizations. So that is one source of looking at an alternative. I've experienced what Linda has. The problem with reorgs is you have the same problems after you have this long period of churn. What a few of us have been looking at as an alternative, and in fact, I had a conversation in Denver with some people about it yesterday, is teaching really anybody who is willing to learn how to span boundaries and teaching individuals to find common cause, to get comfortable talking to people they don't know in other parts of the organization, so that you've got that connective tissue that's sort of coexisting with the buckets, the organizational units and silos.
So I'll tag on. So just some basic facts. The current organizational structures and designs we have are disastrous in low performance. Like, they're just horrific. Another fact is that we know that culture eats strategy for breakfast. So undertaking a restructure, which is strategy, I think Linda was speaking to, without having the right culture in place is pretty much a waste of time. It's just moving the deck chairs in the Titanic. However, if imagining we do have the right culture in place, things are, leaders are showing up in positive ways, people are feeling engaged and so on, and we want to undertake a restructure. What we want to do, and I've seen this, help undertake this many times very successfully, is to, nobody wants to be told what to do or how to be restructured. Because usually what happens in the business usual is oh, we're too centralized, so we'll decentralize. Now we're too decentralized, so we'll centralize. And it goes back and forth. And it's just a big waste of time, wasted energy, waste of money. Waste people's time and decrease their level of engagement. So the resolution of this is to help people understand, like, there's no right answer because every organization is its own complex system. However, there's certain patterns from lean, from agile portfolio management. We want to have stable product teams working with stable product lines. There's some very common patterns. So step one is to get the people together from all levels of the organization, from the different silos together, in a room, I don't know, 20, 30, 40, 50 people, whatever the number is, to get enough information in the room to make an intelligent decision, educate them on what are the basic principles and what are the tensions and trade-offs, educate them on here's what we're trying to do with our business, this is what we want to achieve, these are the constraints, we have this many people, and then get them to work in groups to talk to each other and listen to each other and figure out and co-create what are intelligent solutions. And when you do that, and each group, table group, make a solution, and they propose it back to everyone else, and then they say, oh, that's really interesting. And then you mix it all up, and then you have the next, then you share the knowledge, because that way you get the group wisdom and intelligence to make it to solve this complex problem. And when you do that, and that group comes up with a solution, people like it. They go, oh my God, our lives are better now. And everybody knows somebody who is in that room, and there's so many ambassadors for the change, and everybody has this understanding of why these decisions were made. And then it sticks, and then it's powerful, and then it can launch the organization towards higher performance. But that's usually not what happens.
Thank you for that, Michael. Yep, Alex?
No.
Oh, okay.
Sorry.
No worries. I just thought you might have had something to add on to that. Let me throw a question out here. I'm gonna go into another question after this, but this just reminded me of a conversation I had with a deputy CIO, and it's about this sort of topic of reorganizing government structure to improve agility, collaboration. And I really like what Michael just explained about getting all the people into the room and start breaking them into groups and come up with solutions and everybody talk and buy in, and it's great. What about the SDLC? I mean, he really wanted to throw it out the window. He said, I want to take the SDLC and throw it out the window and start new and just get rid of it. Because if you have it there, it's blocking you on both sides. It's creating all this documentation, and it makes it really tough. So Alex, I would love to hear if Switzerland has a solution to this, and how do they fix it? What do we do with the SDLC, and how do we help these government executives be as agile and nimble as they can be? And maybe Kitty has a thought process. I'm not sure, Mike. I'm sure, Michael, I'm sure you have something, but I would love to hear you guys' thoughts on that.
So if I correctly understand, the question is about how to make the management, how to move and make that transformation happen. You need to have strong managers that are really willing to have to change, had different experience, had experience with managers that wanted to say, the only way that we can deliver the product, it will be with Agile. So we help it and we move it, and we were able to bring everyone in the same room, and we were able to work together. And it was fantastic. We really had everything. It was a great example that we are able to do with government people. The people are working in silo, and they start to work together, and they remove the silo, and they start to work. One that is doing DevOps, one doing collaboration, communication, and was great because we had the correct place and the correct environments, and the manager were doing this. In the opposite, where I am currently, it's completely different. the management doesn't really want to have Agile because it's changing their place. They love micromanagement, and you come in and you say, okay, now we're going to have Agile instead to have a resource market every month. I need 2% of that guy, 10% of that guy, and so on. We stop this, and the team will say how much work I can do for each of you guys. You change the way. One way we did it is that we bring the cadence planning. It's something like a PI planning on SAFe, but with other names, other words, because government is government. They need to have different words. They don't want to use the same word than the other one. And we bring this. And the last cadence planning was the 6th of May. They announced that they remove completely the micro management resource markets. Now everyone needed to come to the cadence planning and ask the team, okay, can you give me a little bit of resource and find this? And that was a great moment because you started to see people start to communicate, start to collaborate, and it was great. There was managers that normally is the king of micromanagement, and she was there, and she said to me, oh, how I can see if I can, I have some time for me on this. And I say, oh, you know, it's nearly the end of the cadence planning, so if you're not going to there, I think the team there will say, sorry, we're full for the next few sprints. So it's brilliant. People are coming and it's starting to have the magic. But it took nearly 1 year to bring that magic. Because, yeah, government is government. You need to kill the micromanagement. You need to kill the conflict. When I came the first day, it was in May last year, and I asked the management how you feel, what would be the future. And there was really something. There was the architect, the chief of the architect, he came, he said, architectures, that will be the future of Agile in the government. I say, okay. And then another guy came just after and just strike Agile. I said, okay, we have communication and collaboration problem here. So that was would be the first part. Even before we even talk about anything about Agile, it was the first part is to kill this problem, bring more collaboration, more communication, show what is that architect can be useful for the team and not become an impediment and so on.
Awesome, perfect. I'm wondering if we should move to the question of a success story or an aha moment when people have used boundary spanning to achieve way more than they had expected. Everybody's like, there has to be some success stories.
But I just say a haha moment.
Yes, Alex, that was a good one. That was a good one. I think you're right. That was definitely good. I was just wondering if anybody else had it.
Actually, that's give me a day. I have a lot of aha moments. What I think actually the default everyone that I have known pretty much, or most people in government have thought that the default is it won't work because of all the things that Alex was mentioning. The fact is, in my experience, it can work, but you got to get inside that other person's head. So, for instance, the very first aha moment I had when I moved from San Francisco to Washington and was the project manager on a risk management system to help us. We had 300 people trying to review financial aid operations, student aid at all the colleges and universities in the US. Then there were 7,000 main campuses. So you had 300 people who were supposed to review 7,000 main campuses at least once every 4 years. It was physically impossible. So what we did was work with Coopers and Lybrand quantitative business unit to build a risk management system. And what that involved was getting data from a bunch of different systems at Federal Student Aid that at that time, none of them were talking. They were not talking. They were different data stores, and there weren't, there was sort of a key that you could use to link all the data sets, but it just hadn't been done yet. And this was back when middleware was still a new idea, and XML schema were just sort of becoming useful. And so the one of the aha moments, though, was that, oh, okay, I need the data. So I get this big, just gazillion, what looked like 8-track cassettes from the mainframe at NIH, which is where all of our Pell data were being stored. The problem was there were certain fields. I knew financial aid because I'd done it for 10 years. I couldn't know whether this field meant this or whether it meant this. So the definition wasn't clear. So I needed the people who ran the Pell Grant program, including the accountants, to tell me what it was. Well, they didn't know what it was in the system because the systems guys had never talked to them. So you had an unclear sort of data dictionary, and you had people who really had never talked to each other. You had the Pell Grant accountants, the systems people, and the contractor, and the data stored at NIH, and none of them were talking to each other. And I'm going, this is bad, because we have to know exactly what this data element means before we can use it. So I thought, well, this isn't going to work, probably, but maybe it will. So I just asked the systems guy, hey, could we set up a conference call with your contractor? Could we have you and the Pell Grant program managers, the accountants, in the room together? And could we all talk about this? That was a huge aha. And I'm not kidding you, it seems like a no-brainer now, but that was 1996, and that was like, once we got everybody in the same room, and they're going, hey, I see you guys down the hall once in a while. But they had never met each other. And I'm going, that's just wrong. So we get to talking, and we answered the question in the first 5 minutes. Once everybody knew what it was we wanted to know, it was easy. But the aha was that, a lot of people will, they do want to be asked. They will show up. They're interested in meeting other people in other units. And plus, if you got anybody that's a holdout, sometimes food works, because we did have chocolate chip cookies. So, because I just greased the wheels. I'm going, this has to happen, or we can't move forward.
Food is a great motivator. I totally agree. Or alcohol. Yeah.
And that too.
Or mix them together. I'm not like one pot. Yeah. You know, awesome. Thank you so much, Kitty. That's great. I think the key of what you had mentioned, and it was also a key in Alex's story as well, is, and Mike had mentioned it before, bringing the people together that are involved and talking through the problems themselves. So that's awesome. There's a question from Bill Given over here that I think is really important, and I'm really loving Michael responding to these over here on the chat. Thank you, Michael, for that. From my perspective, risk aversion is as much a feature of government rather than it is a bug. In that context, what are some of the strategies to create that safe space that allow people to innovate? So that was the question from Bill Given. And then Mike had responded, innovation requires safety. Safety is a reflection of the overall culture. Kind of going back to his statement that culture eats strategy for breakfast. I think I might get that as a tattoo. I mean, that sounds like a great idea. And that in that, what did he say after that? So working with risk and innovation requires culture change. Culture change requires a shift in everyone's thinking. everybody's typing too fast for me to read this. I'm sure you guys can all read it. Michael, did you want to go ahead and continue in that vein?
So let me comment. I mean, people want to reduce risk. The biggest risk is your SDLC because projects aren't getting done.
That's what I was asking. Yes, that's exactly the question.
SDLC is the number one risk factor. Agile was created as a way to dissolve and solve 90% of common risks in project delivery, to get people talking to each other, say where there's all the problems, right? And make things transparent so people can see what's going on and adapt to what's happening. So the highest, so all these controls that you have and controls on controls and controls on controls and controls and reports and everything like that is the risk. It prevents the organization from being, from delivering. It creates a fossilization and a numbing of people's brains as they get crushed under all the red tape and the bureaucracy. That's the truth of it. That's why there's a, like, unless people can actually see the reality of what's going on, can acknowledge the depth of despair and suffering people in, the lack of engagement that comes from these crushing red tapes, mind-numbing processes. Once people go like, oh, well, geez, what we're doing here is not high performance. What we're doing here is terrible, terrible performance. Why are we doing this? What do high performance companies do? How do they innovate? It's like, well, I mean, Bill was pointing to this. They have safe spaces. They innovate. They take risks. Well, are we as leaders taking risks? Are we modeling that? And then Bill's going, well, ooh, if we want to move to a higher performance culture, and that requires a shift of everyone behaving differently, how do we actually start shifting behaviors? Mm-hmm. It starts with desire. Mm-hmm. People actually need to see the horrific truth of what's really happening and desire a change for themselves, mm-hmm. right? And this can happen by anyone in the organization. It could happen in a team. It could happen by the department head. It could happen with the top. It could happen anywhere. So this, oh, we need to wait for our leaders, is total nonsense. Everyone here listening on the call can move to a more adaptable, higher performance organization tomorrow by shifting their own behavior. How we're more flexible, how we're more adaptive, how we listen more, how we co-create more. It's all possible.
I'd like to jump in I'm not muted. So to just pivot on that a little bit and talk about maybe another aha moment. When I came to NASA, I said, oh man, this is so great. I love to innovate. There's going to be a culture of innovation. I can't wait here and to get here and try all my great ideas out. And so my aha moment is that it wasn't really a culture of innovation. It's a culture of managing risk, right? And so I really share a lot of what Mike said about how risk is sometimes an antithesis to innovation. But when you look at the mission that NASA has to do, you can kind of understand this risk mindset when they are sending billions of dollars of equipment into space and human lives into space, then a risk tolerance kind of gets pretty low. Do you wonder why the next generation of spacecraft looks a lot like Apollo? Isn't that interesting? Isn't that very interesting? Because it's safe, it's proven, and that kind of stuff. So somewhere in this yin and yang of risk mitigation and innovation probably is the right kind of balance. And I think the challenge from leaders, from a cultural perspective, is helping the organization achieve that balance.
Yeah, if anybody's been on a NASA proposal, that's a fun one of 1,000 pages and 18 binders, and you get to learn really quick what a risk management is.
So I'm curious, Linda and Michael, if what your response would be to this. It seems to me that one of the things that's needed then is, and there is a question in here about leadership, the people who are you can call them the executive sponsor for the project, the people whose butts are on the line, whose names will appear in the Washington Post if something really terribly goes wrong, if it isn't partly a case of, you know, I've worked for some really good federal leaders and private sector leaders too in colleges. And I've worked for some really terrible ones. The really good ones know the rules really well. So for instance, the SDLC, Software Development Lifecycle, they know what that is. They know what it's supposed to do. And so, and they have the confidence, because they know things so well, to say, okay, these are the things we can throw out. This is a paper exercise. We don't need to do it. But these are the few things we must preserve, and it does not take away from your ability to do Agile. What do you think about that?
So I think that one of the problems with leadership is really not understanding what you just said. To look at Agile as being like the new shiny thing that comes in that they want to do, or the other extreme, to look at SDLC as the warm, fuzzy, comfortable thing that they've been dealing with, you know, forever. In the middle, you know, is there needs to be a tolerance for a certain amount of leadership discomfort, maybe some leadership risk, or to put it another way, some courageous leadership, which I think in some ways are lacking, all right? I hate to say that. But I say that SDLC is not for every single kind of project, nor is Agile for every single kind of project. A leader that comes in, it would behoove them to know the difference.
Yeah, thank you for the question, Kitty. I actually agree with your sentiment that people who are effective leaders understand what's essential and what will actually really lead to product success, and what is just noise in the way and is actually going to slow things down and actually harm things. I think there's a big misunderstanding going on here, that somehow there's an impression that Agile is a process or a set of practices. That's true. Agile typically is pointing towards some processes. Scrum is the most notable one, Kanban's another, that are ways of working very specific work practices. But the real value of Agile comes from the Agile mindset, which is actually towards pointing to a shift in the culture system where people are working together, creating together, thinking together, having open discussions. That's what's going to lead to high performance on a product, on a project. Doesn't matter. That's really at the deepest level. That's what we're advocating here, is you will get this whole SDLC. I mean, that's mostly a disaster, but you know, or Agile, it's not about that. It's actually about really having an honest conversation. How do we, as the people responsible for this product or project, what do we think will serve us in delivering this successfully? What do we think will get in our way? How can we organize ourselves intelligently? It's really about creating a place for people to start thinking. That's the deepest intention of Agile, and inviting people to step up as responsible adults. That's really, really what it's all about. And then, you know, and there's structures, there's teams and all this other stuff and some processes to create visibility, blah, 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 blah. But that's really the deepest intent of Agile, is, hey, let's get together and figure out how to work. And like get some awesome stuff done so we feel good about it, and the people who are paying out our salaries feel good about it too.
Awesome. I kind of want to make a shift panel over to the resources question, just because I'm looking at the time and I wanted to open it up for story time for the attendees as well. So right now I would love to chat a little bit about resources. I know, Kitty, you said you had three lined up. Linda, I know you might have some in mind as well. Michael, you might have some in mind. Alex, so I thought we could just go now kind of like around the team and talk about what resources have worked for you in the past, which ones you really like, and all those. Kitty, you want to start?
Okay. So I didn't want to talk all the time. So, and I'm thinking I can actually I can tell you what they are really quickly, and then I can actually send the information to you guys so that you can put it out, okay? The one I mentioned earlier was The Neuroscience of Leadership by David Rock and Jeffrey Schwartz. And that may be something I can just PDF and send you, I'll look for a link online. there is an older resource, but there's a reason it was so successful, and that was Chip and Dan Heath's Made to Stick.
Yes, and that's a great one, actually.
I was just thinking about that the other night in the context of this discussion. I think that could help people sort of do the convincing inside the organization, possibly up the chain too, when you have just got to have some executive or middle manager buy-in. And then there is a new report by McKinsey, The Journey to an Agile Organization. The reason I think that's worth looking at is because they sort of lay out what they think the three major transformation archetypes are. And seeing those, it relates to the conversation we've had. So you've got some organizations that can just, that will do little pilots and then expand. Because most organizations, like Michael says, you do need a mindset shift. And, you know, and I've been through one of those, a major one that actually worked at Federal Student Aid, but they're rare. So there are other ways to transform the organization. And McKinsey's three archetypes are useful to help you think. And then a third thing is there's a woman whose last name is Rabe, R-A-B-E, who wrote Innovation Killer, How What We Know Limits What We Can Imagine and What Smart Companies Are Doing About It. And that is back on the silo crossing again, because it's talking about not being so vested in your own point of view and your own work that you literally can't understand what those guys are trying to do. And I think that's a biggie around the SDLC and some of the other sort of artifacts of big government.
Thank you very much, Kitty. Alex or Linda? I see Michael already posted one resource about Agile Adoption Transformation Culture book free download. Thank you, Michael, for that. Mm-hmm. I think Melinda will actually put all of these in the follow-up email. So anybody that had registered or is attending today, you'll get this in an email. So don't feel like you need to copy and paste everything. It'll be handily delivered to you. Linda, did you have one?
I'm trying not to go on forever and ever, but... So kind of to touch on my aha moment, one of the things that I said, this is so disparaging, but I'll say it anyway, like, you ain't seen dumb till you see the smart people at NASA, right? And so there's an article in Harvard Business Review that I used to kind of guide my organizational change activities, which was, I can't remember the exact title, but if you Google the words, Teaching Smart People to Learn, Harvard Business Review, you'll find it. It's in there. So I think it's a very good article about getting the engineering archetype to change. Also, The Heart of Change by Cotter, I think a lot of people know about that. Relative to Agile, we happen to have a white paper, We Muse, that's available for 99 cents on Amazon. So if you just search for Agile Governance, and Eric Watson, our CTO, wrote it. It's just a short white paper. You can email me and I'll send it to you. And that touches into some of this, the yin and yang of bureaucracy and innovation working together, which I think is a reality for a lot of government. So I'll leave it at that.
Thank you, Linda. I really appreciate it. And Alex, want to give you the opportunity.
I'm sorry, time is late. I'm starting a little bit tight.
It's late there. I'm so sorry.
Yeah. It's not far from 10 p.m. So instead, it made me smile on what Linda said, because I had a friend who was working in NASA, and he told me what it was NASA. It was not so nice place that I was imagining, I would say, oh, I wanted to work to NASA. And I say, oh, you know, in NASA, there's a lot of bureaucracy, a lot of politics, and only a few people really working. And I say, okay. Maybe the last word for the in the government is, change in government is taking a lot of time, much more in the private place. There's a lot of tools that you could use in the private place, you can't. It's not gonna work because people feel protected around the process. If they don't want to work, they have the right to not work. Transparency is not a good thing for most of them. So they will try to avoid any transparency. So you really need to bring more, as Michael say, more around the mindsets. First, communication, collaboration, before even bring any agile practice, don't come there to talk, oh, we're gonna put in place Scrum, or we're gonna put this or this. It's not gonna work. Some people will say, oh yes, we want, but most of the people will say, no, I remember in a workshop, I present Scrum to a team and the managers at the end, they say, oh, by the way, we will not follow the Agile Bible that Alex presents. Alex is not Jesus. We will do our own Agile. And it makes me smile. And it's exactly what you found there. People try to keep the ownership on the new process. It's very special environment compared to the private. So one thing that I bring and allow to make change is a retrospective. Try to get retrospective, team retrospective, organization retrospective. It's hello and it helped to bring little bit after little bit, baby step to bring something. As I say, like the one I'm following currently is the Confederation. It's like the federal government is on the retirement. It's very, very slow, but that's the government. I know that most probably I will stay there for several more years. I told them, maybe I will see Agile. Maybe it's my grandchildren will see the Agile there. But yeah, when you're there, you understand. I remember the first time I coached a government entity was, I think it was something like 10 years ago. After 3 weeks, people come to me and they say, oh, Alex, are you not afraid? You're going to stay with us and try to bring Angela? I say, yes, I'm going to stay. And I like the challenge. I will try. If I run away, you will know. At that time, I moved from a trading environment to the agile environment. It was like taking an airplane, and it was an airplane moving to 4G and moving 1 point to minus 1G. So it was very strange. Everything is slow. Talking about the risk, I don't know how it is in US. In Switzerland, what we do, what they do, the government say, to limit the risk that the project will cost much more, they spend millions on study, everything, limit the risk. Some project that in the private will cost maybe 200,000, in the government will cost 2,200,000 because you have 2 million to prepare to limit the risk. It's just crazy things. And when you work in the government, you need to, say, okay, I didn't hear this. I know it's my tax they will use, but let's see. This is government.
Yeah. Alex, I don't want to cut you off, but we've only got 5 minutes left. So Melinda is probably going to do her book giveaway. And I apologize for everybody that was excited to share your story. At least we got to see your face.
And you know, honestly, people have been sharing in the chat so much. Yeah. There's been so much going on over there. Hoping to summarize and somehow preserve that for us to learn from and look over later. I know we have a whole lot of experience represented amongst the audience here as well today. So lots of really good stuff there.
Some really big names in there. I was like, oh, Ann Duncan's here?
Hey. Just a lot of, you know, boots on the ground. You know, people have been doing this and there's a lot of knowledge that's here to be shared. But yeah, we have the personal Kanban book. And Kanban, I mean, that's just good for anything. I organize my summer with that, or your garage cleaning, or your work, or, you know, if you're new to these practices or you just want to try something out. So we're giving this book away. Participant chosen at random for this is Sarah Williams. If you are here and would like to claim your copy of the book, just speak up or say something in the chat. Oh yeah, she wants it. Okay, great. I will email you after and connect with you to get that book to you. And in the meanwhile, we have this recording we'll be distributing, and we'll collect all those resources together and make sure that everyone can benefit from those. And we'll also circulate information again about the organization, this nonprofit that's working hard to bring these conversations together, create community where we can continue to learn and share from one another. And you can also learn more about that at agileGovLeaders.org/join and learn about membership opportunities to continue to learn and grow here with us. I think we're good and finishing a little early, but thank you all so much for being here today. And thank you for sharing, panelists. Yes, thank you so much for your time. We really appreciate it. Take care, everyone.
Thank you.